I'm delighted to welcome all of you to a very special event, our annual Deinard Memorial Lecture on Law and Medicine. I'm Susan Wolfe. I'm chair of the university's Consortium on Law and Values in Health, Environment, Life Sciences. We are one of three sponsors of this lecture. The Joint Degree Program on Law, Science, and Technology, directed by Professor Hari Asofsky, is another sponsor, and the University's Center for Bioethics, led by Susan Craddock. So on behalf of all three of us, I'd like to welcome you. Our speaker today, as you know, is Professor Sidney Watson from St. Louis University Law School on an issue of immense importance, lessons from Ferguson and beyond, bias, health, and justice. And we're privileged to have a truly expert commentator, my colleague, Professor Kola Okuyemi from the university. I'm going to introduce both of them properly in a few minutes. So I think you're in for a very exciting, deeply searching morning as we look at these issues. Just to give you the lay of the land, Professor Watson's going to talk for about 35 or 40 minutes. Professor Okuyemi's going to come up and talk for probably about 10 minutes. And then we're all going to adjourn over here for question and answers. There's a lot of tremendous expertise in this room. So I hope you will all come up to these mics, introduce yourself, and share your thinking and your questions. I would like to particularly acknowledge our guest this morning, Dr. Lewis Sullivan, the former Secretary of the Department of Health and Human Services. So we're very privileged, Dr. Sullivan, to have you with us. And as I already warned you, I hope you're going to ask particularly difficult questions. I have confidence. This is, to my knowledge, the only dedicated lecture series in the country focusing on the immense issues at the intersection of law and medicine. And we are deeply indebted to Professor Amos Deinard Jr., Miriam Kellen, who are children of Amos Deinard Sr., as well as the law firm of Stinson, Leonard, and Street. I'm going to tell you in a moment, the Deinard brothers, Amos Deinard Sr. and Benedict S. Deinard, were founding partners of this Minneapolis-based, enormously distinguished firm. And we're very lucky that both Professor Deinard and Ms. Kellen, as well as the law firm, have joined together to support this very unique and significant lecture series. At the firm, Byron Starnes and Sheva Sanders have been particularly instrumental in making sure that every year we stay on target, and they just hosted this morning our speaker at the law firm, so this is a true partnership. I'd like to just take a moment to tell those of you who don't know a little bit about the enormously distinguished history of the Deinard brothers, in whose memory we convened this morning for the lecture series. The Deinard brothers, as I mentioned, were founding partners of the firm that was then named Leonard Street and Deinard. Both brothers attended our law school here as well as Harvard Law School. Amos Deinard was a distinguished attorney, widely known for his persistent work to eliminate discrimination in hiring. He was appointed to the Minneapolis Fair Employment Practices Commission in 1945 by then Mayor Hubert Humphrey. He served on the commission for 17 years, 15 of those as chairman. Benedict Deinard was a successful trial lawyer, an adjunct professor of law at our law school here, a deputy attorney general in the U.S. Department of Justice during World War II, and one of only four civilians asked to participate in the Nuremberg war trials. This lecture series commemorates their memory. A few little pieces of housekeeping. Those of you who want CME credit or CLE credit, you need to make sure to complete and submit a participation form. They're out at the table in the foyer. And other health professionals who want to seek continuing education credit, you need to submit a statement of participation to your accrediting organization or state board for consideration of credit. An evaluation form is going to be emailed to all of you very rapidly after this lecture. So if you wouldn't mind just taking 5 minutes to give us your feedback, we read all of it and take it very seriously. It's enormously helpful. I should say that none of the speakers or planners have disclosures this morning. And with that, I'm going to now properly introduce our lead speaker, and then introduce Dr. Okuyemi when it's time for his commentary. Professor Sidney Watson is the Jane and Bruce Robert Professor in one of the most distinguished, really, epicenters of health law in the country, the Center for Health Law Studies at St. Louis University School of Law. She is a longtime specialist in healthcare access for the poor, and has spent her legal career advocating on behalf of low-income people, both as a legal services attorney and now as a law professor. Currently, she is advocating for better access to high-quality, affordable health insurance and health care by serving as policy and legal advisor for a statewide coalition of grassroots consumer health advocates. She's received funding from the Missouri Foundation for Health to support this work, and the law school's grassroots health law policy and advocacy course, and I think this is truly pioneering. It allows students to do grassroots health policy work on behalf of consumers. I think we could learn from your model. She is a longtime colleague and a frequent speaker to consumer, disabilities rights, children's groups about the Affordable Care Act, about Medicaid, and about access to care. She's a prolific scholar, editor of the American Bar Association publication entitled Representing the Poor and Homeless, Innovations in Advocacy, and has authored two books directly germane to our lecture here today. Join me in welcoming Sidney Watson.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to be here today. Thank you, Susan, for that wonderful introduction. Thank you to the Deinard family for a tradition of caring about justice and community. I've heard the stories. I've met you. This lecture is just part of what you've given to this community over many, many years, so I'm very honored to be part of that tradition. My title today is Bias, Health, and Justice, Lessons from Ferguson. It's a title that Susan and I selected way last fall, before the death, the shooting of Jamar Clark. I live in a city in St. Louis that over the last 2 years has been consumed by the shooting of Michael Brown by the police, about the reality of life in predominantly black communities, about life where the police profile black men, the police arrest black men, the police shoot black men, according to the Chicago police in Chicago, at least 3 times more than white men, where young African-American men between the ages of 18 and 34, the leading cause of death is homicide. I didn't anticipate that this would come to your community, that you would become part of this national conversation that's required many of us, like myself, who are white, to not face reality. And I ask you today to join with me to think about what life means for black America, for black Americans. The shootings of Michael Brown and Jamar Clark and Walter Scott, Freddie Gray, and the names go on, have sparked protests and sparked demonstrations. The iconic Black Matter signs bring us back to the point of race. And a lot of the conversation has been the immediate context about policing standards, police profiling, police training, police discipline. But I think it's also forced us as a nation, as a community, as different communities, as states, to talk about that larger context of what life is like for Black Americans and Black communities. And I could now be a typical public health person and speak to you about the research that talks about the toll that racism in this world, in this community, in this country takes on Black Americans, how it impacts stress, how day-to-day slights impact mental health, and how that affects health. But I instead will recommend to you Ta-Nehisi Coates' award-winning book, Between the World and Me. It's a moving letter to his son, from a Black father to a Black son, about growing up in America and becoming a man in America. And I quote Coates when he says, racism is a visceral experience. It dislodges brains. It blocks airways. It rips muscle. It extracts organs. It cracks bones. It breaks teeth. For the scientist in the room, the research and the quantitative numbers are important. But hearing those words remind us that we do walk in different worlds, and we need to be able to see the world through others' eyes and through others' experiences. As my student, or one of my students from Ferguson, talked with me right after the shooting of Michael Brown, her family was facing what they call the conversation. Her 14-year-old nephew is a cross-country runner. He trains every morning before school by running through the streets of Ferguson. He's African American. When it's cold, he wears a sweatshirt. It has a hoodie on it. And his mother thought it was time to explain to him the dangers of being a Black young man running through the streets of Ferguson, and she dreaded having the conversation and what she had to say to him about what that meant for his future life, and fear of police and of others in my community. Coates calls that looking out for my body. He talks about the mental energy it takes as a Black man to constantly be careful of where one places one's body, how one moves one's body, so that it does not attract violence from the police or from others. Something that most of us never experience in this country. So Ferguson requires us to think about race and racism. You know, race really isn't important without the racism part. Race is not a biological construct, we know that. Race is a social category, but in this country, given our history of slavery, we do categorize based upon race, and particularly around African Americans. And while my talk today, I think, is important about empathy and considering all in terms of issues of racism, I do want to focus on African Americans today, because the Black Lives Matter calls us to remember our history as a country. Our history of slavery, our history of segregation, our history of Jim Crow, and to remember how that impacts lives in this country in many different ways. The structural, big picture ways in which families were torn apart during slavery years, and we're still putting those African American families back together. Structural ways that we didn't allow African American families to take out home mortgages and build up wealth. The structural ways in which police departments have been historically white and done policing in communities of color. It's discrimination that also operates at an institutional level. whether it's the police department or the local court. Many times we have policing rules that appear facially neutral, but they operate in ways that impact African Americans as individuals and communities more harshly. We also have interpersonal contact, some in which there is intentional discrimination and bias, but just as often is unconscious. For many of us, it's crossing the road when you see a young black man in a hoodie, because you make a subconscious assumption about that young man. The picture on this slide is a picture of traffic court in Ferguson. One of the things we discovered as we broadened our conversation about race in our community is that our traffic courts have been operating in ways that reflect structural bias, institutional bias, and interpersonal bias. The city of Ferguson, like many of the cities on the northern part of our community, have been financing themselves through traffic fines. They set up blocks and they stop people for the slightest infraction, not having a headlight, driving a couple of miles over the speed limit. If you don't show up at traffic court, an arrest warrant is issued and you get arrested. If you do show up at traffic court and you can't pay the fine, and oh, by the way, the policy had been there was no month-to-month repayment, you were put in jail. Structural bias, because our predominantly white communities don't use this financing and police stop, traffic stop system. Institutional bias, because you know what? I know lawyers. I can always get my tickets fixed. That's part of the system. Only people who have to pay in this system are people who don't know a lawyer, who don't have a friend who knows the judge. And those folks are African Americans in the Ferguson community. And it happens on the interpersonal level, because when you do get stopped, folks like me can talk their way out of it. Folks with minimum wage jobs don't. What you see here is an amnesty day that occurred after the publicity around Michael Brown's shooting. It was an attempt to clear up some of these fines. We had people who could not go to their jobs for fear they would be arrested. And it is this intersection of structural, institutional, and interpersonal bias that act in our world. Not just with policing, not just with court systems, but also in the healthcare system. This is the cover from the 2003 Institute of Medicine study, Unequal Treatment. It is a literature review. It is a discussion of racial and ethnic disparities in healthcare. And it talks about the structural bias that exists in our pay-as-you-go healthcare system, where if you don't have insurance, you can't get health care. It talks about the institutional bias that happens when dentists refuse to take Medicaid patients, when hospitals refuse to locate in African American neighborhoods. And it recounts the hundreds of studies that had been done up until that time that also talked about interpersonal bias in healthcare. Clinical differences in care. Study after study has shown when African Americans have the same health problem, the same source of payment, they get less referrals for specialty care, less surgery, less pain management than do white Americans. And I want to say something else about the Institute of Medicine study. It was groundbreaking to have this information. It sparked a national debate at its time about health disparities, particularly racial and ethnic disparities. And I actually trace the use of the word disparities, at least in the racial and ethnic context, to the Institute of Medicine study. It went out of its way to say it didn't know if it was discrimination, at least not in the legal sense of the term. And it made a point of using the disparities to say it was pointing out differences. And I have to say, at the time, I thought that was a very good idea. Because when we say this word discrimination, we say the words bias, many of us don't want to hear anything more. I'm not biased. I'm not prejudiced. The use of the word disparities was a strategic and important tool to try to open up our ears, to be open to thinking about difference and improving care for African Americans. And I think that's really important. But I also think that what we have learned from the last 2 years, when the national news has shone a spotlight on African American communities, is we need to use the hard words too. Because this is long-standing. And the healthcare system in this country has a different relationship with African Americans than it does with any other ethnic group. Because we had slavery, a time during which medical researchers experimented on black bodies. We are a country that up until the 1960s excluded African Americans from a white healthcare system. My introduction to this issue was in the 1970s. I was a legal services lawyer. My first job was in New Orleans, Louisiana. My first week on the job, one of my colleagues invited me to meet with a group of moms he had been working with in a public housing project. They had some problems with the housing project. But he said, you ought to talk to them about some issues they're having in getting medical care for their children. So I went to this meeting, met this great group of women. They all worked part-time at the hotels in New Orleans. Didn't have private health insurance because they were part-time. They didn't qualify for private health insurance. But they did have Medicaid. And here's what they told me. This is the one thing as a lawyer you could do for us. We can take our Medicaid cards and we can go over to Charity Hospital, the public hospital in town. And they'll see us and they'll see our children. But you know, it actually takes almost 12 hours to get seen because there's no appointment system over there. And it just takes so long, we lose a whole day of work. What we'd really like to do is take this card and go to Ochsner Hospital, or Baptist Hospital, or Methodist Hospital, any of the private hospitals located near their homes, but they couldn't get in. At that time in New Orleans was about an 80% African American city. When we looked at the private hospitals and their inpatient census, we got those censuses by race. African Americans served in those private hospitals in New Orleans, the census was between 1% and 3% African American. African Americans were expected to use charity. What was happening? Every one of those hospitals had a policy of either outright refusing to accept Medicaid or limiting the number of Medicaid patients it would take. They were, in effect, redlining the African American community. That's an example of an institutional policy. The hospitals would tell you, and they told us when we filed a lawsuit, that it was about money. Medicaid paid less. The bottom line made sense that they took better insured patients who paid more. It really wasn't about race. And when we talk about bias and when we talk about discrimination, it's important to own how many of these racially neutral policies are out there that negatively impact the African American community. It's also really important to acknowledge that we struggled with this issue for 10 years in New Orleans. And the story is, it has a good outcome. They all decided to take Medicaid because we had too many hospital beds, and all of a sudden they needed more patients to fill up empty beds. And suddenly the Medicaid, although it didn't pay as much as private insurance, looked financially appropriate. Money speaks here. Money's important in the healthcare system. We have to be clear that much of the institutional and structural problems we have are tied with money, are tied up with the intersection of poverty, race, and class. But I can't stop there, because what the Institute of Medicine study and other studies have made clear is that even when African Americans have the same health insurance, have the same income level, on these interpersonal levels, they still get less care than white Americans. It's complicated. It's about race. It's about income. It's about many things. And I spend the time saying that because many of us talk about health equity. And as I talk today about bias and discrimination, I want to talk about the goal I have, that many of us have, when we talk about equity. Because equity recognizes that equality, where the idea is there's a level playing field, and if everybody, you know, has a box of the same size, they'll be able to reach over the fence or to reach that healthy apple up there, is not going to be enough to address this history that operates on so many levels. Our goal should be equity, and in equity, some people are going to need a larger box, a higher box, to reach the goal. And that's a piece of where we talk a lot about the social determinants of health. We talk about the way where you live, where you work, where you play impacts your health. We talk about economic stability and having a decent job, having any job, having a job that pays a minimum wage, a living wage. We talk about housing. We talk about education. We talk about food. We talk about social supports. And we become much more sophisticated in learning that all of this affects somebody's health and welfare. It's not just the medical care you receive. And just as important, though, we normally talk about discrimination as operating at the community and social context level. I'm hoping that I'm reminding you that discrimination works at all of these levels, that it's harder to get your resume reviewed if you have an African-American name and harder to get hired. When you're looking for housing, it's harder to get through the screening if you have an African-American name. And why is it that my African-American research assistant had to get me to sign off as a co-signer on her student apartment when I have never seen that happen to any of my white students? We know that education in schools in minority neighborhoods tend to be poorer, and the discrimination that happens. We've heard about food deserts and why and how grocery stores don't operate or set up in minority neighborhoods. And yes, I've already talked about there's even bias or discrimination that occurs in the healthcare system. And we put all of these together, and when we want to talk about creating health equity, moving everybody forward to the goal, we have to realize that racial segregation in housing, that these concentrations of neighborhoods of poor people, maldistribution of healthcare assets and resources, and vast differences in health outcomes occur at the zip code level. It's about neighborhood. It's about community. Here's a map that doesn't make a whole lot of sense to me, I'll be very honest, but this is your community. It's from a report, The Unequal Distribution of Health in the Twin Cities, prepared by the Wilder Foundation, commissioned by your Blue Cross Blue Shield of Minnesota, updated and reported in your newspaper about a year ago. The darker the spots, the lower the life expectancies. There is, in fact, a 13-year life expectancy difference across the Twin Cities. I don't know the neighborhoods, but if you are like the rest of America, you will know that those are African-American neighborhoods, right? Because housing discrimination means less choice, less food, less jobs, less transportation, and we end up with communities of color suffering the health benefits. These are the Fergusons. Here's the slide from my community. It's two zip codes. The zip code on your left is Clayton, Missouri. It's an inner ring suburb. The life expectancy is 85 years. You'll also notice that it's about 78% white. Median household income of $90,000. On your right is an inner city zip code that's right close to where my law school is. It's in North St. Louis City, a life expectancy of 67 years. That's an 18-year difference. And it is a 95% African-American neighborhood, an unemployment rate of 24%, a median household income of $15,000. The good jobs in my community are out in Clayton. The transportation to get from North City to Clayton barely exists. When my law students go into these neighborhoods to try to help people sign up for new marketplace plans, we find that nobody makes enough money to qualify for subsidies. If we had Medicaid expansion, people would be Medicaid eligible. They're not. We speak in churches where almost 100% of the church community, if they're under 65, is uninsured. It all fits together to affect help. Here are some more numbers from your region. This is from a health inequities report. It was tracking changes in age-adjusted mortality, and I really applaud you for doing it, for tracking this. I applaud you for being careful to think about race and ethnicity and to actually get down into some important factors, including the difference that may happen between African Americans who are foreign-born, and the experience of African-Americans who are native-born. The numbers, the higher the number, the worse it is in terms of mortality. You want those numbers to be low. So in 2007, per 100,000 residents, overall 244 people would die. You can see that you made great strides in reducing mortality for foreign-born African-Americans, for Asians, minus 30% even for American Indians, and I realize the challenges that community has here. But when you go to the bottom, it went the other way for the native-born African-American communities, lost ground in terms of health. And here's another statistic from your own reports. Looking at mortality rates again by race and ethnicity, but this time also stratifying the data by income. And just a reminder, income matters. But it's this first dash line is African Americans. At the lower end of the income scale, less than 35,000, they're right under American Indians. As we go higher up on the income scale, still notice African American mortality rates are higher than other groups. I'm not going to purport to be the researcher that knows all the answers on this. But I think a lot of what we suspect is this is the stress of living in African American communities, of living in a society that in so many ways is biased against African Americans, the subtle discrimination, the subtle bias that wears and wears on people. And this is from a recent study on quality of care and disparities. The short version of this slide is you want to be blue. You don't want to be red or white. So on the top is the states that have higher quality health scores. Not surprisingly, Minnesota is blue. When you look at the data on how you are doing in terms of the quality of health care, it's always true in every report, Minnesota does well. You are the state we aspire to. When I testify before the Missouri legislature, my mantra is, we should be Minnesota. Or if we were Minnesota, this is what we would do. But here's what else we find, is that when we take apart that quality data and we look at it in terms of subgroups, whether it be African Americans, people with disabilities, other racial and ethnic groups, states with better quality scores to begin with tend to have higher disparities among groups. You may be doing very well in serving your majority white population, but don't leave others behind. And that's where you see Minnesota is red. You're not doing as well. And it's actually embarrassing when my state beats you out. But that's a talk for another day. So we have lots of things to think about here, right? We have the social determinants of health, where you live, work, and play are really important in your quality of life and your health. We need to think about delivering health care. We need to think about differences in the care we deliver. We need to think about institutional rules that impact African American communities. And we have the Affordable Care Act, right? Passed 6 years ago, and it was a health insurance agenda. We started out wondering what it would be and what it would turn into, but by and large, it reforms health insurance in this country by trying to create a system in which everyone has access to a form of health insurance, be it Medicaid for the very poorest Americans, new marketplace and marketplace subsidies for moderate income Americans. And yes, when we passed the Affordable Care Act, we thought that would happen in every state. After NFIB v. Sebelius, the case challenging the constitutionality of the Medicaid expansion, we still have a Medicaid expansion, but it is voluntary with the states. And this is the most recent map of which states have opted to expand Medicaid, like Minnesota. But we still have 19 states that have not. And you can't look at the map without realizing that the former states of the Confederacy, the states that fought the Civil War, are the bulk of the states that have not expanded Medicaid. And when we look at the 3 million people, who are uninsured, who could be covered by Medicaid, they are disproportionately black because that is the population of the states in the South. Those are also states that have a long history of racism, of Jim Crow, of racial turmoil. I also want to just kind of mention in here, I am talking about African American health. One of the interesting things the national statistics show us is that with Medicaid expansion, we have actually been a little more successful in covering Hispanic Americans than we have even white Americans. And while I always focus on Texas and Florida not expanding, because New York in Arizona and California have expanded, we have really made a difference in reducing uninsurance among Hispanic populations because so many people live in that area. But I also want to talk about another part of the Affordable Care Act because as it started through Congress, and we were focused on health insurance reforms. Many people were concerned about a health equity agenda, that as we move to think about expanding insurance, that we think carefully about the African American community, the Hispanic community, the disabilities community, the rural community, that we think about these communities we live in and leave no one behind, try to reduce barriers as we could. And I want to tell you about an extraordinary group that came together at the grassroots to work on a health equity agenda, the National Working Group on Health Disparities and Health Reform. And I will refer you to Daniel Dawes' new book, 150 Years of Obamacare, which explains this movement for 150 years toward health equity, traces it, but also gives you a lot of detail about the work that was done around health equity in the Affordable Care Act. And we're so grateful to Daniel, who's now at Morehouse Medical School doing this work, and his leadership. But a group came together. Initially, it was 35 organizations. It grew very quickly to be 250 organizations. It included groups that had traditionally worked on racial disparities. It also included disability rights groups, groups that worked on sex discrimination, LGBTQ discrimination, rural discrimination. They agreed that to talk with one voice about discrimination, about disparities, about underserved groups, about disadvantaged groups was important to raise attention. They also left to each group the responsibility of speaking to their own issues, whether it's African American health or LGBT health. And in that work, they created an advocacy strategy to talk to Congress. They created model language for including in the Affordable Care Act. As a group, they monitored and analyzed proposals. They did the on-the-ground work of lobbying. And they're also working to monitor implementation. And hear what some of their points were. If we are going to have health insurance reform, let's make sure that that health insurance includes prevention and wellness and public health initiatives, so we're addressing those social determinants of health where you live, work, play, as well as the health care piece. That it's important to address workforce development, that we have a diverse workforce that models the patients we serve, that understands the patients we serve, that is located in communities where patients need to be served. It's also important that we have data collection and reporting. I ran out of room for all the words I wanted to put there. That includes race, ethnicity, gender, disability status, so we can disaggregate that data about quality and access and know when we are leaving communities behind and be called to attend to it. They also advocated for a new civil rights law to be included in the Affordable Care Act that says it is illegal to discriminate in health care programs. So let me talk about Section 1557 of the Affordable Care Act. Passed one section, it has been the law of the land now for 6 years. How many of you have heard of it? Okay, that's good. I'm feeling good. That's pretty good. It is the first health-specific anti-discrimination law. We have had other civil rights laws that apply in the health and healthcare context, but they are general laws like the Americans with Disabilities Act, Title VI of the Civil Rights Act. This one is for health. It builds on four law-standing civil rights laws, and that's important in terms of the advocacy that got the legislation passed. Part of the negotiations were in terms of prohibited grounds of discrimination. We will build on what came before. And what does it prohibit? Both intentional discrimination and facially neutral policies that have a disparate racial impact. That's powerful. A definition of discrimination that says we need to attend to whether it's money or oversight or just the way we've always done business, rules that exclude African Americans or other minority groups, because we have to think about better ways of doing business. So here's my graphic. For the lawyers in the room, the text of Section 1557 is pretty much incomprehensible, and one always wonders about those drafting. Instead of saying it prohibits discrimination based upon race, disability, age, and sex, it cross-references some other statutes. I want to show you a little bit about how that bills. So Title VI of the 1964 Civil Rights Act forbids race, color, and national origin discrimination. Very important, that has been interpreted to include discrimination based upon limited English language proficiency. This is the law by which we provide translators and interpreters to people who don't speak English as a first language. Section 504 forbids discrimination based upon disability, and it is quite clear that that includes HIV and AIDS status. So 1557 reaches that. The Age Discrimination Act is age, right? We get that. Kind of carving out some, we have many special programs that do have age restrictions like Medicare or Social Security, and that's embedded as exceptions in the what is prohibited discrimination. And a particular interest is Title IX. That is the legislation that forbids sex discrimination in educational programs. We have never had a civil rights law, an anti-discrimination provision that prohibits sex discrimination in healthcare. The only place it reached was Title VII with some employer-provided benefits. So 1557 is the first anti-discrimination provision that reaches sex discrimination, because it builds on Title IX's definition that includes gender identity and sex stereotyping. And it may also reach sexual orientation. There is some conversation going on with HHS now about whether it reaches that. Many advocacy groups have encouraged HHS to define it that way. Stay tuned for the answer there. Section 1557 has a very broad reach. It applies to, I had up there all health programs and activities, which one of these three things: any part of which receives federal financial assistance. So federal financial assistance is Medicaid, Medicare, those new federal premium tax credits which are helping people purchase plans on the marketplace. Are you with me? So I'm going to stop here. This is on the next slide, but let me. So a private insurance company that sells plans on the marketplace and enrolls people and gets premium tax credits to help with their costs is subject to 1557. This is the first time we have had a civil rights provision that reaches private insurance companies. Coverage. This is a big deal. It also reaches any health program that is administered by HHS or any other federal agency. NIH and research, even if there's no money flowing. HRSA programs, even if there's no money flowing. You can imagine any other number. And finally, it reaches programs administered by Title I of the Affordable Care Act. That's the language in the statute. I wanted you to see it. It's basically, it applies to the new health insurance marketplaces. It applies to the navigator and assister programs that help with those marketplaces. Again, it reaches private insurance as well as other federal funding. So health programs and activities, what does it include? Services, hospitals, clinics, nursing homes, private physicians' offices, health insurance, health education program, health research. I will say that the proposed rules make very clear that this does not require that every research program enroll every person. It recognizes that there are different research questions, but it does require that we attend. It also covers state and local governments that get federal funding. It also directly covers federal health programs. And we had no civil rights provision covering race and ethnicity that included Medicare before. It covers HHS itself. HHS must now administer its programs in a way that do not discriminate based upon race, ethnicity, sex, disability, or age. And that's important. There's an enforcement mechanism. You can file administrative complaints with the Office of Civil Rights. The Office of Civil Rights can also do compliance reviews. For example, they might come out and look at how nursing homes are operating and where they are locating. There's also judicial relief. There's also a right to file private lawsuits challenging this. So let me tell you a little bit about some of the administrative complaints that have been filed. The National Health Law Pro... Oh, and one thing about complaints I'll just mention. You don't have to be the person discriminated against. You can file an administrative complaint on behalf of a third party. So if you're a community activist here or somebody from a community grassroots organization, this may be a way you can help people in your organization. The people you serve. So the National Health Law Program and the AIDS Institute filed an administrative complaint alleging that four Florida health insurers had put all AIDS drugs on the highest cost tier, alleged there was an adverse impact on that, that the intent was to discourage discourage people living with HIV from enrolling in these health plans. They have successfully resolved that. The National Women's Law Center has filed many complaints, including against some long-term care insurers for charging women more than men for long-term care. And there have been at least two lawsuits. One of them is Bramble versus Fairview Hospital, filed here in Minnesota, where a transgendered individual alleged that he had been rudely, hostily, roughly treated during an exam in the emergency room, and a federal court here in Minnesota has allowed that lawsuit to proceed, calling Section 1557 a new health-specific civil rights remedy. So in my final minutes, I want to talk about how Section 1557 can be a tool to educate, a tool to promote community and institution-level conversations about how we could reduce racial bias and improve health equity. I think it's a quote by Senator Bill Frist who said, lawsuits never won anyone true equality. Maybe he's right, maybe he's wrong. There's a place for lawsuits. There's also a place for internal conversation. So one of the things that HHS has proposed for Section 1557, and we have a notice of proposed rulemaking that was issued in the fall, we hope to see the final rules in the next couple of months, is that all health programs subject to 1557 should have a health civil rights compliance program. You know how your hospital or your clinic has a compliance program around HIPAA and privacy? The idea is we should also have, I'd prefer to call this a health equity compliance officer, someone to pay attention. There need to be notices of non-discrimination, grievance procedures, post-information. In a perfect world, a place to make sure the conversation happens. Just as important in these proposed regulations, HHS has provided very specific, very substantive guidance on how health programs need to begin thinking about better serving protected groups. So, for example, with sex discrimination and differences based on sex, these rules say our goal is equal program access. And then it has pages of kind of specifics to think about to make that happen. The goal for limited English proficiency and translator services is meaningful access, making sure that the services we offer can be meaningful, fully used by people who don't speak English. And for people with disabilities, it talks about the kind of reasonable modification, which may have some costs associated with it, that need to be done to make IT and web and buildings accessible. And it is that level of detail we have never had from HHS that is helpful. It's one thing to say do not discriminate. It's another thing to begin the conversation about what are those policies and practices and unconscious things that are going on that are creating barriers, and what is our goal. And I commend HHS for doing this. My heart is broken, though, that these proposed regulations do not mention discrimination based upon race and ethnicity. It is shocking to me to have read the proposed regulations and see a section, discrimination based on sex, discrimination based on disability, discrimination based on limited English proficiency, and there is nothing about discrimination based on race and ethnicity. Many of us filed comments about that, explaining the need for specificity, the need for help, the need for guidance, the need to prompt the conversation. The Congressional Black Caucus has submitted a letter. I don't know what happens next. But I do know what we need. And this can happen at the sub-regulatory level at HHS. This can happen in individual programs, in individual communities through compliance officers, equity officers, or through community groups who care about equity. Is we need to have a conversation about what our goal is in terms of reducing bias, reducing discrimination, improving access and quality of care. Time's up. So, do we mean meaningful access? Do we mean reasonable accommodation? How do we make that happen? And how do we make it happen in a lot of different ways? It's not just nursing homes and hospitals and private insurance networks, all of which are important. But as we transform the healthcare system and we are looking at things like quality benchmarking and payment and value-based purchasing from CMS, that those systems are not set up by CMS in a way that disadvantage African-American communities who have greater health needs, that disadvantage safety net providers who serve the sickest of our community. We need to attend to how all of these laws impact the African-American community and impact people. I'm going to skip this one and ask you to join me in a grassroots effort. I want to tell you about HELEN, the Health Equity Leadership and Exchange Network based at Morehouse, which is trying to bring together and become a forum for health equity champions, a way to share this information, a way to empower people, a way to collaboratively engage communities in conversations about how to use Section 1557 and other remedies. The link is here. You can sign up. You can become part of this conversation, and maybe I can tell you more about that in our question and answer. I leave you with Black Lives Matter as a protest movement means many different things to many people. It should remind us of the power, not just of the street, but the power of people. In 1965, when Medicare was enacted, we had racially segregated hospitals in this country. 2 years later, they had been desegregated. It was a combination of a civil rights provision, Title VI, that applied to federally funded programs, hospitals wanting Medicare. We put the two together and demanded, as the cost of getting Medicare, that hospitals had to desegregate. But that desegregation only happened because in communities across this country, we had doctors, we had nurses, we had the National Medical Association, we had local civil rights leaders who volunteered, who went to those hospitals, who became the boots on the ground that made change happen. We have the Affordable Care Act. We have some new tools. Change only happens if we have communities speaking out. Thank you.
I wanted to let everyone know that we are videotaping. And within about a week, up on the Consortium website, this tape will be freely accessible. You can share it with other people. You can use it for teaching. You can watch it again. So keep your eye out for that. Our commentator is Dr. Kola Okuyemi, who is a tenured professor of family medicine and community health here at the University of Minnesota. He also directs the program in health disparities research at our medical school. He is director, additionally, of the cancer health disparities for Masonic Cancer Center, the program looking at those issues. Just briefly, Dr. Okuyemi was recognized nationally as among the top five NIH-funded researchers in the entire United States in 2010. At the program in health disparities here at the medical school, he leads a very dynamic interdisciplinary team of more than 25 junior, mid-career, and senior health disparities research scientists looking at a range of areas with extramural funding, mostly from NIH, including nicotine-dependent smoking cessation, nutrition, obesity, kidney disease, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, health services research, and the patient-provider relationship. Dr. Okuyemi.
Should I say good morning or good afternoon? We've been here for a while. I want to thank Susan and the other sponsors of this really exciting meeting, and Professor Watson for that brilliant presentation. How do you comment on that? But I have to do what I've been invited here to do. And I was also told that there are several folks who are waiting for the panel session and who have yet to speak. So I'll make my comments brief. Initially, I was wondering, oh, what do I have to say? But now you have to stop me once I start start talking. So there are three big themes that I picked resonated from Professor Watson's excellent presentation, and they're probably not new to most of you here. The first among them is the issue of bias, which she presented. I mean, she could have talked for hours on that issue alone, but just gave us a snapshot of how the overwhelming evidence of bias and discrimination. Although she spoke mostly of healthcare, but it's like you can name your field and name the topic, name the issue. There's bias in there. So I'm challenging us to reflect within our own discipline. Within our own walks of life, to not ignore the fact that the bias and discrimination, even if not obvious to us, exist in education, in universities, not just Minnesota, most institutions of higher learning, in housing. In employment, hiring decisions. In an institution like this, how such committees make their decisions, who gets invited to fill leadership roles. And when we talk about stereotypes, when we talk about bias are driven by stereotypes. And stereotype is something many of us have maybe familiar with, but unless you've experienced it, you may not be asking the tough questions. Stereotypes often result from experiences, isolated individual experiences that you may have had with people from a particular community, and those experiences become what we call single stories. Single stories that we now come to apply to once, every time we are dealing with somebody from that particular community. The problem with that is single stories are dangerous. As this famous author Chimamanda Adichie puts it, that single stories are now portrayed to be the only story about a particular culture or community of people, and they tend to give us incomplete potentially damaging understanding about other people. Secondly, stereotypes could also be driven by false belief. One recent example was a study that just came out of University of Virginia, which really was stunning, again, because this was done among medical students. The University of Virginia is a top rank university where they looked at about 200 white medical students and asking them, posting some scenarios, questions to them, including some statements that are clearly untrue or false, including what they think whether it's true or not. There are three that I picked out here. Number one is blacks' nerve endings are less sensitive than whites. So they were asked to say whether that is true or not. Another statement they were posed that was posed to them is that the black's skin is thicker than white skin. And they thought, for the sake of time, is that blacks have stronger immune system than whites. You can, I won't ask for a show of hands about what you think about those questions. Now, 50% of these white medical students. Now, these are not students who are not supposed to know something. If you know how tough it is to get into medical school these days, you will know that these are as smart as they come. Less than 10% of folks who want to get into medical school actually get in there. So 50% of them, believe that one or more of those statements are actually true. But not only that, there was a correlation between these false beliefs and how these students assessed pain and recommended treatment for their patients. So we've known for a long time that there is racial bias, but this is one of the first studies that will now link that to false belief. So it doesn't matter how strongly you believe something. If it's not true, it is untrue, and interestingly enough, the same experiment was done among non-white students, and there was no correlation between false beliefs and treatment for these students. So we have issues that we need to be asking ourselves and reflecting within our own context. We talk about the police a lot, as if police are out of a different planet. The same findings that we're seeing about how police treat minority communities, the same is happening in most other settings, just not as well reported. Secondly, is the issue of mistrust, and according to Google. We used to talk about Webster and Oxford Dictionary, but Google and Wikipedia has taken over. That mistrust is a feeling that someone or something cannot be relied on. And when there's mistrust, the outcome doesn't matter, right? The outcome really doesn't matter if there's no trust between two entities. At best, if the outcome is good, you know, people breathe a sigh of relief, say, "Oh, thank God that we don't have to, you know, go out and complain about that." Talk less of when the outcome is negative, and many times, you know, the system waits until maybe the jury is about to announce their results before they start wondering, okay, let's, you know, try and see what we can do about the Black Lives Matter so they don't disrupt, you know, things. That is too late. The big picture that is missing is the issue of mistrust. And I won't, you know, take much time to tell you that polls after polls have shown that communities don't have that high level of trust in their either in their police or their mm-hmm. or their other structures within their system, and finally, one of the slides I like the most is the one talking about social determinants of health, which is talking about upstream and downstream approaches. Which is where we really have the problems today, and that's where the solutions will come from. Now, to quote the great German pathologist Rudolf Virchow, who was sent to Upper Silesia, that's about 150 years ago, to investigate the typhus epidemic. In the report that he came back with, he did not focus on a search for the bacteria itself, or the vectors that may be transmitting the bacteria. Instead, he called the attention of the government to the social and economic and cultural factors that are responsible for the epidemic. He argued that it is in education and full employment lay the cures and the prevention of future epidemics. So, you know, if we know that the primary determinants of disease and the health of a population are social and economic, then the solutions must, in a significant way, include social and economic factors. So the problem is not that we're not spending enough money to address health disparities, but the problem is that we're throwing more money at what we call downstream solutions, with less money spent on upstream issues. In upstream issues, as economic stability, education, jobs, employment, addressing hunger and people's access to healthy foods, health insurance coverage is an upstream issue. That if there's no adequate coverage, if there's no good access, you can raise the quality as much as you can. Like Professor Watson rightly described it, one of the unintended consequence of good quality care is to make disparities, and that's what you'll find in a place like Minnesota here that leads the nation. In quality of healthcare, we have here among the worst health disparities. So the issue is not just let's provide better quality. We're saying let's invest more in upstream measures. Let's invest in early childhood education so that when that kid shows up, but if in the first day in kindergarten, he or she is not 2 to 3 years behind his or her peers. Let's invest in employment, in housing, policies. Let's invest in communities and address the issue of hungers. And it's only when we do this that we will have any chance to create a situation where everyone has the best chance to attain the best possible health status. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sullivan.
First of all, let me say thank you very much to our speaker and commentator. This is a very important issue confronting us today. I'd like to make a comment and then raise a question. During my lifetime, I've seen the election of our first black mayor, Carl Stokes of Cleveland, members of Congress, though we did have some after the end of the Civil War, two governors, Doug Wilder in Virginia and the governor of Massachusetts, whose name momentarily escapes me. We seem to have done very well in responding to those prominent individuals assuming positions of leadership in our country. And we've seen the election of our first black president, where I, like so many others, thought really this now shows that we as a nation have matured, where race is less important. But I've been struck by the fact that there have been so many instances where I feel that the office of the president has not been respected during the term of President Obama as it has been respected in the past. Because we've always felt that the president is a special person and the office is an office of dignity that represents all of us as individuals. Now, with that statement, my question is this. Well, let me make one other statement. As all of you know, the Census Bureau has pointed out by the year 2042, roughly, we will no longer have a white majority in our population. And we have been blessed as a nation of positions of leadership because of our scientific innovations. Our system, our capitalist system, has stimulated innovation, et cetera. But we have now, with this growing demographic change, a growing segment of our population that is not as well educated, not served by the health system as well as the white majority has. And I maintain that if we as a nation are to continue to have positions of leadership, we have to be sure that all segments of our population are well educated, have good health services. So with all of that, my question is this. I'd love to have comments as to whether or not my observation is really anomalous or off base, but it seems to me we've really, rather than being advanced as a nation in terms of putting racial issues to rest, they seem to have had more striking racial reactions, including the Ferguson incident and the others here. And if that's the case, any thoughts as to how can we get beyond this? Because during my lifetime, I have been proud of what's happened, starting with the March on Washington and all of the things since that time. But the last 8 years or so, to me, have really been more reactionary rather than moving forward.
Thank you.
Oh.
Well, this is the downside of having an elder statesman, one of the wisest thinkers about these issues in the audience. To some extent, your remarks are so well put, they answer themselves. But, you know, I think we have held up individual examples of success and leadership, whether it's President Obama or African-American senators, and told ourselves we have moved ahead. I think with the election of President Obama, we wanted to believe we were a colorblind nation. And I think what we have allowed to happen is the festering of problems, that we had the luxury, at least those of us who are white, to ignore very serious problems of race in this country. And I think what has happened over the last 2 years is it has exploded and required our attention. I don't know that that answers your question, but I think for me it's that demanding of attention we cannot turn away. We cannot afford to turn away for the reasons you say. We need to embrace each other. We need to figure out the upstream solutions. And we can't pretend that color blindness or individual examples of success mean that there is no issue anymore. Kola, would you like to comment?
Well, I wish I have the the solution. We won't be where we are today. I think your observation is perfectly correct. We don't like being uncomfortable. And issues around race, discussions around race can be very uncomfortable. And as I'm blanking out on the author who said, in order to engage in conversations around race that will move us forward, we need to become comfortable with being uncomfortable. And there's no way around it. The conversations need to happen. And our politicians are not helping. They're not helping our situations because there's a lot of coded language used out there. A lot of opposition against the Affordable Care Act is coded opposition against minorities and against the poor and low socioeconomic groups, which can be named, but the opposition is called something else, because we're not back in the Jim Crow, age. I think minorities also need to, make the conversation, I don't want to say easier, make it possible for those conversations to happen. I don't believe there can be a good conversation if the intention is to assume that, every white person is racist, or every white person was making unconscious bias, which exists a lot in healthcare, that every physician who is treating a black person differently is racist, but rather to approach it from the fact that a lot of how we relate has to do with what we grew up with, and there are several things that we grew up with that may have been normal then, that are not normal right now, and we need to help folks to make it easier for them to talk about it without necessarily labeling people. Which just makes people withdraw, and that doesn't change or help anything.
Other questions?
Hi, Don Brunkwell, formerly of Children's Hospitals of Minnesota, now the Center for Bioethics. And I want to thank you for pointing out Section 1557. Mm-hmm. I did not raise my hand that I had previously heard about that. But I want to ask where the rubber meets the road question. For hospitals, in terms of regulations and oversight, the rubber meets the road with CMS and the Joint Commission. The notice of proposed rulemaking suggests that we're 2-3 years away from having any 1557 rules, because those things move at glacial speed. Is there anything preventing CMS from developing regulations? Is there any movement within CMS or from the medical community to just move ahead with regulations that appropriately identify issues of race as something that needs closer attention in the hospitals? And if there isn't, can you envision anything that would accomplish that?
I think there's a number of things you say. I will say we are not 3 years away from 1557 regulations. We know they are in OMB for the final look, so God forbid they should be out in 30 to 60 days. I think the other part of what you said that I did not mention in my talk is the Office of Civil Rights at HHS is not part of CMS. For those of you in the room who are part of healthcare, CMS is so crucially important to us because that is the part that comes up with the payment rules. And one of my ongoing concerns is the Office of Civil Rights is over here, CMS is over here, Office of Civil Rights is writing discrimination equity rules, CMS is doing payment rules over here. And if these don't work together, we all know that the money wins out, right? And that has been one ongoing kind of recommendation we have made, that these should be integrated. I do think it is interesting that CMS's rules now will be subject to these anti-discrimination provisions, and it will be interesting to see how that plays out. But it's really an interagency power struggle to some extent. On your question of how do we get specificity quickly, I actually think the opportunity to do sub-regulatory guidance is interesting. When HHS does regulations, it takes months. And then to change it, it takes months and years. Sub-regulatory guidance allows HHS to move more quickly, to be more fluid. And I think we might be better served by sub-regulatory guidance here. I have encouraged HHS to do interagency task force, have people working together, bring in stakeholders, do community level meetings, and then we can have evolving guidance. And I think many of us are interested in that as an approach, but we need the conversation, the guidance.
There's a question over here.
Well, thank you for having this great conversation. My name is Hattie Bonds, and I am a almost 40-year retired public school administrator, an old science teacher, an old activist from the 70s, a new activist of today with what's going on, and of course being very disappointed that these young people nowadays are doing the same fighting that we had to fight in 1970. What I'm really interested in hearing about more of this upstream solution, and I know you've had lots of experience as well, and you brought it up, but if both of you could kind of respond to that and talk more a little bit about what would those specifically upstream solutions look like, because I think therein lies one of the quandaries that we are in, where we're doing the downstream still, and we need to do the upstream. First of all, who's responsible for it? What specifically are some of those things that we need to be doing? That's really a struggle with me right now, because I've seen different generations go through these same things, and here we are again. And as you have this wonderful bill going through now, and then to leave out racial disparity and inequality, very much like you, it tears me apart, because I thought, oh, there's a glimmer of hope here. That's what I can do. That's what we can do as old activists now, to bridge that gap between the old and the young, show them how to do that. So what are some of the upstreams now, and who specifically are responsible for those? Because we have new laws going in that are really terrorizing right now as we speak, with the new ones.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
thank you.
Wow. We can talk about so many examples. I mean, to start from the police, community relationships, which is one that we see in the media every day. I believe that the police and their related agencies need to build serious trust building initiatives with communities of color. Before any problems arise, people need to be validated. People need not to be stereotyped when they bring up specific issues in their communities. So that is one. Probably a bigger issue is the ignoring the fact that many of these committees are dealing with huge unemployment issues. And when we don't have programs that are targeted to producing jobs in these communities, and then we're trying to fight the repercussions downstream, that is never going to work. I think the health commissioner several months ago was talking about the issue of the minimum wage. There's a Chinese proverb that says that nobody that wakes up before dawn, 365 days a year, should fail to put food on the table for his or her family. But that is happening in this country. So there are folks who have full-time employment, but it's not a living wage. So that is an upstream approach. Whenever we have the opportunity to support that, I know there can be so many different reasons. So some small businesses yet are rightly concerned that maybe it will drive their business down. But it's something we have to deal with. So that's an upstream approach. You know, finally, one that comes close home, in an academic setting. You know, I think about a week ago, I took part in what was my first experience of a bias training for such committee members. So these are leaders in the medical school who serve on various such committees, and I've been trained to recognize that there are embedded bias to watch out for in the search process. You know, elating and encouraging to see that we're not waiting till when you're down to the last three finalists and say, well, sorry, you know, we did not intentionally exclude the minorities of women, but there were no qualified ones in the pool, which is the downstream approach. That's an example of providing training, because in many cases, these are not intentional biases. People are just not aware of what they are doing by excluding some folks with some of the decisions they make.
I wish I had the one solution. I think my answer is more process-oriented. We've had two parallel processes going on in St. Louis. One's a direct result of the shooting of Michael Brown, and it's our own. It's called the Ferguson Commission. It was set up by our governor. It's community members. It's some of the protest leaders. It's pastors from throughout the area who have really looked at the issues in our community. And they have issued a report, and I would commend it to you. It is called the Ferguson Commission Report. I would suggest you look at their website, which is full of stories of being black in St. Louis. But they are upstream solutions. But their primary solution is that every decision that is made at a policy level, at an institutional level in our community, that there has to be a first question: what is the racial impact of this decision? What is the racial impact as we continue in my city to do high-tech development in the white part of town and not focus on African-American neighborhoods? What is the racial impact of how we are structuring our mass transit? Some questions that we have not always answered or addressed, and that be at the forefront. The parallel process that's been going on for us is called For the Sake of All, and it is a community-based research project and empowerment project co-facilitated by Washington University and St. Louis University, which is really focused on community-level disparities, community-level housing, economic development, jobs, all of those programs, and has begun for us community conversations about the school system, jobs, job training, where at the center again of that conversation is, what's the racial impact? are we blinding ourselves? This has to be a part of the conversation. And they have done both reports that make it clear to us what are the community level disparities and the impact of discrimination on those disparities, as well as beginning to pull together both community activists and people with the jobs and in positions of governmental power to have the conversations to begin to move forward. There really is an implementation part of it. So I don't think I have one answer, but I think it's the engagement.
We have unfortunately reached the end of this part of our time together. Our speakers, I think, have done a spectacular job of beginning a conversation. Some of you, yes. Some of you are remaining for the invitational lunch. That's on the fourth floor of this building in the Campus Club Rooms B and C. And Dr. Okuyemi is going to lead a conversation among us there. I do want to thank our spectacular staff members, particularly Catherine Grimes and Jeanette Gagnon, for bringing us, convening us here today, and hope that you will come back April 21. We're going to continue our other lecture series on the microbiome. Thank all of you for coming, and thanks especially to our speakers.